And then speaking of Mos Def and, mm-hmm. and other mm-hmm. young rappers mm-hmm. who are poets, mm-hmm. When did you decide to become involved with them? Uh-huh. Because I know that mm-hmm. they honor you mm-hmm. as...
Oh, I honor them.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, even the ones who are crazy, because yes. I know they won't be crazy forever. See, America has a way of popping you back. You yes. know, like, you know, you'll be crazy. Like, I'm out here, and you got the booty, you know, yes. and, you know, and a boop, and boop. I always say, I mean, and I think because they know that I love them when I do it, you know. I get on stage, I say, it's still there, you know. It ain't left. You know, it's still there. I got, you know, I have to give props to Mungu and Marani, my children, because I used to be like everybody else. I used to come home, and they'd be playing this rap music in a loud, loud way, and I'd come in, slam the door, put my card, and you know, right there and say, turn it down! I can't hear myself think. I heard it all the way out there on the bouncing off, and they would go, you know how your children go.
Yes, of course.
But I would always drop my briefcase right over there and go in, because I believe tea helps you a great deal after you've been out and fighting the war. So I would put my water on. And they were playing right there in the family room, right? And, you know, I said, who's that? And they told me who it was. And I said, I said, I don't understand the thing they're saying. So they said, I think Mungu said, I'll play it back for you. So I'm putting on my tea, you know. I don't understand a thing. On Sundays, you know, we didn't go to church. And I always worry sometimes if I, you know, about, you know, not putting my children in that environment, not taking them there. But what we did at home for 2 hours, we would do, take the phone off the hook, and we would talk about, I would give them a book, read, Here I Stand. And I will talk about it for 1 hour from my point of view of teaching it and whatever, and what Robeson meant with other folks. And you then respond and you talk about it too. And we did that. We would play a Malcolm or W.E.B. Du Bois talking about, with that aristocratic voice, I was born in, you know, whatever. Just amazing. And then we would respond to it for 2 hours in this house from 11 to 1, no telephone, no idiot box. No, nothing, no ping pong on the third floor, but we were talking. And so one day they brought a friend in. I hope I'm not going to embarrass him. And you know, we were vegetarians, so their friends used to struggle with our stuff, you know, that we ate. Even they struggled with the stuff that we ate, right? And I heard them whispering about some girl. I mean, evidently she was like, you know, as the old folks would say, fast, you know, whatever. And so I sit down at the table, and I said, well, so she gives it up to people, huh? You know, whatever. And, you know, my children were always embarrassed sometimes. And I'm sure they thought many a time, like, mom. And they looked at mom. And the other kids would say, Miss Sanchez, you don't understand this. I said, yeah, but it seems to me that if she gives it up, you know, and he gives it up, then they're both the same, you know, like they're both, you know, like, you know, whatever.
Giving it up.
Well, they ate in silence. It was silence at the table. They got up, you know, and I said, I'll do the dishes, don't worry. And they went up the steps, up with their whatever. I know they're really embarrassed by it. But on Monday morning, I said to them as we were heading out, I said, our session will be on sex. I said, so you do all the stuff you need, and I'll do all that I know, whatever, et cetera. And I said, I'll go first, whatever. So I went first. And I brought out the book when they were little. I had a book. Well, actually, he might not remember this, and I hope it won't embarrass him. I heard them arguing. They were coming down the hallway, but I had the door shut, which meant that you don't come in, you know? And I was jumping off the shower, because the bathroom's right up, and I was literally turning, going to the radio, and they burst in from fighting, and they just stopped like this. I said, yeah, it's mommy. I said, mommy has breasts. I used to breastfeed the two of you. Can you imagine that? And mommy has a vagina, and you have a penis. Now get out the room so I can dry myself off, slam, and close the door. And they did. They were all still fighting, you know, about something, arguing. And I said, stop arguing. So I gave them, later on, I read this book, Peter and Caroline. I don't know about their little, with their daughter. And they were naked. And I read it to them, and I was pointing out all the parts, whatever, et cetera, you know, family ever did that. So I read that, started off with that. I talked about, you know, when I grew up in Harlem, about the girls, you know, who gave it up and what they call them in the neighborhood and how they always call us the good girls for some, you know, we're the good girls, whatever, because we didn't, you know, do stuff in the hallways or whatever, that we listened to our parents, whatever. Then I also read an excerpt from Lady Chatterley's Lover, which I thought was, I mean, I wasn't sure about that, you know, for a minute, but, you know, but to talk about love, you know, yes. That there's love, you know, and there's sex, whatever, et cetera, and boom. And then they did what they did, whatever. But it was still there. I really still think they thought, like, you know, the girl was who she was, you know,
yes.
And they weren't. I mean, the boys, you know, that's the double standard
that's
there
right.
was there. But Monday morning, Mungu passes by me and said, we're going to do a thing on music, Mom. I went, whoa, you know, whatever. And he was saying, we got you. He really was saying. And he said, you go first. You know, so I went first with my Coltrane, my Miles, my Bach, because in this house, when they came down the steps on the Sunday, there's no telling what they're going to hear. They're going to hear Bach, and they said, what's that? I said, Bach, or Beethoven's Ninth. I said, but this, you have to stand here and direct, whatever. So my children were exposed to Ravel, a lot of people, a lot of jazz, you know, a lot of rhythm and blues, because, you know, from my dad, et cetera, whatever. So I played all of that. And I even play Stevie because I love Stevie and I know they love Stevie too. Then they started off interested enough with Stevie and also with Coltrane.
Coltrane.
Yeah, they did because they had heard so much Coltrane coming from my room, you know. And then they went
that
to...
That was your favorite jazz
Yeah,
artist.
Coltrane. Oh, yes. Right. Yes. He's a genius.
Yes.
Really. And so... then I leaned back like I was like this, of course, with Coltrane. I leaned back and I said, I don't understand it. And then Mungu said, it's okay, Mom. I'll start it again. He put the tape back in, right? I said, did he say, Father? No, put it back in. And then I, like those children and Meg Evans, I leaned forward. Because then when Mungu stopped it this time, and Miranda was sitting there looking at me and said, I don't understand why you don't hear this, you know, because they hear it. They could hear it, right? Mungu said, Mom, do you realize as fast as you talk that it is hard for us to understand you? Mm-hmm. And I went, whoa. And then I said, what is this? Why are you not trying to understand this? Because you think you don't have to understand it or you don't need to understand it. And I went, well, let me listen to it. And then I leaned forward and I made my ears listen. And I went, whoa. So I said, can I borrow this? You know, wherever they gave me the tape, because a lot of them were tapes at that time. And I put the tapes in. So I started listening to in the house, you know, when they were away, I started listening and I started going. Then they started having conferences where I, in order when I went to the conferences with these young rappers, I had to know what they were doing.
Of course.
Then I had to, you know, at some point, and then I would go and I would agree with the ones who were really good. And then I'd say to them, like, man, why did you do that CD, why did you do that video and have that young woman get on her all fours, come towards you lapping? And he said something that was so significant. He said, I wrote it, but I didn't know she'd do it. Anybody would do it. I said, my brother, if you write it
right
and sing it and talk it, then you know there's someone there gonna do it. You know that. You know, and then one next to him, this is at Howard, by the way, one next to him said, well, some of them are hoes. And I said, your mama, I was at the other end. And the place went up and some people roared. And the guy leaned forward like, I didn't expect that out of you, Miss Sanchez, whatever. I said, that's the point. If you call that sister a hoe, then we have to call your mama a hoe. So every time you do it and I see you, I'm going to say, your mama. You know, whatever, and you're going to get mad, right? I was doing, trying to teach, whatever.
Of course.
So you're not just calling that sister because she's coming like this and like this, a hoe, you know, or even if she's acting in that fashion, is it not important for you if you know she's acting and you have more sense about this music and this business that you say to her, You don't have to do that, sister. You can be in my music video, whatever, you know, and just show that you're able to do the movements, whatever, but you don't have to crawl and come lapping. I said, someone said something really smart on that. I mean, I'm talking about these were contentious things. The early ones were really, I mean, they were like, whoa. Because sometime later, someone called me a bitch on the radio because I talked the way I talked, you know, but people called and said, no, these brothers, and I'm talking about people like Talib. I mean, they called it, no, and the guy, I'm sorry, because they're allowed to do it.
Yes,
they call anybody.
Course.
They say, I mean, they laugh at Rosa Parks, you know. I heard on the radio in New York. They were talking about Rosa Parks. Yeah, they're up and up. I'm talking about Rosa Parks. Who's Rosa Parks? She didn't do nothing. I got a telephone.
Yes.
I said, you know, let me tell. I said, once upon a time, you would have picked up this phone and I would have cursed you out. I said, I don't do that anymore. I said, because I know, you just don't know. I said, let me tell you who she was, okay? Let me just tell you who this woman was. And the reason why you have a radio program today is because people like Rosa Parks went through the fire. I said, but you have a radio program not to be dumb or stupid or ignorant. You have a radio program to continue this, whatever. I hung the telephone, whatever. So I'm just saying, it's because I know why. You know, he couldn't think of a word to call me. So he was just saying, you know, like, because. But I said to the brothers, I mean, Baraka and Raz and Talib and Def, all of them called and said, you don't do that. You know who
Good.
The sister is, whatever, et cetera. So what they did, they educated him, but also they put him on pause to say, you can't just do this to anybody. On there.
And it was good that it came from one of their peers.
Of course.
Yes.
It has to come from their peers, too. But
yes.
Also
or
even anybody. You know,
yes.
So, but what they're saying at some point is that if you listen to a lot of these shows, they're saying, we have carte blanche.
Yes.
These people don't care what we say. We can say whatever we want. And we're saying, when I'm listening, I call them and say, you can't say anything you want. You can listen for a minute. You might want to hang up, but I'm here to tell you. We'll call back, you know. And we could very well, like, this is a terrible thing to say. We could very well boycott you. Now, we don't want to boycott you.
No.
We want to give youth a chance, but you have to have some kind of intelligence with this, okay? And some idea that there's a history before you. You are on the radio because people came before you and struggled and died for you to get here. Now, at least play the stuff and be responsible. That's all we're saying, okay? And you can act crazy. You can go, whoo, whatever. I don't care. But you cannot be disrespectful.
Absolutely.
And you cannot be ignorant. That's the other part,
ignorant.
You know.
Oh,
you
yes.
cannot be that, you see, period.
And there isn't any excuse for them to be ignorant.
Yeah, yeah.
Actually.
Yeah. Except that I think sometimes it is thought that it is being smart.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's being like
ignorant is to be hip.
Or, yeah. I mean, they don't know it's ignorant. I think that what they say comes out to be, you know, not really very smart. But I think they think it's hip when they laugh at someone like Rosa Parks, or like when with that film Barbershop, when
yes.
they began to talk about her. I mean, some kids, young people go and think that was hip. Well, who she thinks she is? I can talk about anybody I want to. That's what I meant. They think
yes.
that it's hip. You see, and I'm saying it's not. Hip at all.
No.
Because you see, you watch other groups of people, they don't denigrate their people who have been involved with a struggle the way in this fashion, you see. You don't ever see that at all, period.
No.
And so all we're saying to you is that we're not asking you to worship anybody. We're asking you to recognize the fact of what they've done, how they have moved. So, you know, I got involved from panel discussions and also from saying to people, at Temple, I brought Chuck D down. To talk to the students, and he was amazing with those students and very progressive, you know, because I know these young people are listening to us. So Chuck came down, gave a talk and sang a little bit. So that's how I started hanging out with some of the young people and getting on programs with them and performing with them. I was supposed to do Talib's last CD, and every time he scheduled for me to come and do a taping with him, something happened with my dad, you know.
Yes.
So finally, I finally said to him, go ahead and do it without me because I can't figure this out. I mean, sometimes it seems like we're okay, and you're here sometimes, and you come in, he's not doing well, I can't do it, you know. So just go ahead and do it without me at that point. But my next CD, you know, when he's in town, he's going to do that, and Ursula's going to do it, and Jill's going to do it, so we can have that cross-generational. As it were, we do have a cross-generational with T.C. Carson. You know, when I perform it at, I sent you all the invitation, but I know you were probably moving at Tribeca. Toshi Reagan, who is the daughter of Bernice Reagan, the great woman, you know, civil rights woman, SNCC woman, and Sweetheart in the Rock, comes on stage and sings the blues with me. Oh. And, you know, it's amazing, you know. And I said to them, we're going to do this, and we're going to show people that we can. This is cross-generational.
Yes.
So these young brothers and sisters doing the boot dance, I got out and did Catch the Fire, the piece I did for Bill.
Yes.
You know, and they were doing it in step, and I'm doing Catch the Fire. It's amazing a thing that happened there.
I think they want that.
Yeah. And it, not only do they want it,
yes,
they stop and they turn around and they look at you and they hug you because they know that they have entered another plane.
Yes.
You see, you've taken them to another plane, another point where they should go. Because what I say to them, you can't stay. The point of saying to those students, I'll see you in 1 year when you're 16, is that they'll be at another point.
That's right.
And I want to meet them at that point.
That's
right. You know, they'll be alive at another point. And that's what, so they can see how they evolve.
Yes.
And I can see how they've evolved also, too.
Yes.
I love these brothers and these sisters who are doing this stuff. And every place I go now, I try to make sure that one is with me. So when we have a conversation, they're there. And to question us, to ask us what's going on, so young people can see them there too, and then can see, well, Ursula's sitting next to me. Okay, Ursula's going to take that place later on. You see, you're teaching them that, you know, this happens like this. You know, Talib is there, Death is there. They're going to take that place, pick up that mantle, and continue this thing. And they do it, and they will do it well also too. That's so important.
With a consciousness.
Yes, with a consciousness.
Yes,
right.
Absolutely.
Yeah.